Okay, thank you, David, for the introduction and for the invite to talk today, and thanks you all for coming out. It's one of those kind of talks that you get invited to give, and you get excited about it, and then you prepare it and realize there's not that much to talk about in the area. So I think I've learned a fair bit actually in trying to prepare this. And it's intriguing because, you know, we know a lot about the actual interaction between nutrition and exercise, but when it comes to combining those two things in the context of mitochondrial biogenesis, there's really actually little data out there to look into. So you'll have to give me a little bit of flexibility here, where what I've tried to do is actually think about, you know, potentially what strategies might there be in terms of maybe model systems, cell culture models, rodent studies that we might actually be able to ultimately translate into human studies. So I'm going to start off by talking about studies that we do know in humans, where we've seen a change in mitochondrial respiration that David has shown, and I'll steal some of his data for this concept, and just look at the actual nutritional status of these individuals when they were actually undergoing training. And then look at three areas that I think are actually quite interesting going forward. So that is manipulating energy sensing pathways in skeletal muscle, and there's some nice data out there looking at epicatechins, in particular dark chocolate derived epicatechins, which is always quite interesting because it means we might be able to eat more dark chocolate. Talk a little bit about some of the work we've been doing relating to NAD donors and how we might actually be able to manipulate the system of NAD synthesis to change mitochondrial function. And then finally, look into some of the literature around omega-3 fish oil supplementation, because I think, again, that's quite intriguing because it seems that we can manipulate the membranes of the mitochondria that might actually change some of the adaptive responses. So that's going to be the plan for today. So this is, I think, fantastic review, or two reviews actually, from David's group that have just sort of dropped online recently. And I thought, okay, well, if we take this, where's my so if you actually look at changes in mass-specific mitochondrial respiration that David spoke about, and I thought, well, let's just, you know, out of interest, look at the studies where they've actually seen the most gains over time. So these are the ones that adapted the greatest during that period of time, and then said, okay, well, what was their nutritional status in these studies? You'd assume that if there's fairly substantial gains occurring, that there might be some level of control. And it was really quite intriguing that there's not a huge amount of nutritional control placed. So if we take this study here from Dusan, there was pretty much nothing really controlled during the training, but again, they normalized the nutrition before the actual pre and post exercise training bouts, but nothing regulated during the training period. These two studies where we did see large gains, there was nothing described in the paper about the nutritional status of the athletes during the training period. So your guess is as good as mine as to what happened there. This study was, I think, probably quite typical for human training studies. They didn't want to control nutrition, so they just asked the athletes to maintain what they were habitually doing, and the idea that it wouldn't have an additive effect if they maintained their standard nutrition. This is David's group, so he did a good job, so that's a good thing. So, but interestingly, there was a specificity here towards supporting the high volume training group. So they gave a carbohydrate beverage to support them during that increased load. But again, there wasn't anything really specific for the other group, as far as I can tell. But there was some attention paid to the actual nutrition, and then. Again, the McInnes study, this was out of Madi Gabala's lab. There was control when it came to the actual pre and post testing, but nothing really specific going on during the training period. And then finally, the last one, again, was the some of the biggest gains was, again, just controlling some of the lead into the testing period. So a nice controlled diet for 3 days before the patients actually came into the lab, but there was no real control provided during the actual training period. So I guess the conclusions from that is you can, I think, pretty comfortably say that exercise training is capable of inducing mitochondrial biogenesis independently of a specifically controlled nutritional program. So I think there you can also say, so therefore, is there actually a role for nutrition in this capacity? If I believe there wasn't, I could probably just stop now. I would like to think that, again, knowing what we know about nutrition and exercise and interactions, we could probably do a much better job actually controlling some of these things and then potentially augment the training response. So that was the little bit of background reading I did in preparation. So again, though, if you look into the literature, there's good evidence that if we change the nutritional status of athletes going into training, we can actually sort of augment the training response. So there's some nice literature around training in a faster state versus fed and how that might change some of the adaptive responses, particularly in relation to fat oxidation and skeletal muscle. We've done a little bit around sort of low glycogen training. So again, if you place an additional metabolic stress on the muscle with training, you do seem to change the adaptive response. And then there's this one study using chocolate milk that's from John Ivey's group, where they showed that there was an augmentation of the training response when there's maintained regular ingestion of a carbohydrate protein supplementation. So I think there is evidence there. There's just not a huge volume of literature to support it. So I'm going to go away from these kind of studies and move to an area of interest in my group is really sort of looking at some of these more active ingredients that we know are actually in certain food types. But the point being is it's the active ingredient and the food that's the thing that's probably driving some of this response as opposed to the whole thing itself. So you've probably all heard about resveratrol, quercetin, some of the polyphenols, and some of the other sort of derivatives of these things. And the point being is we've known for a long, long time, and certainly from a number of different historical backgrounds, that most of these foods have positive health benefits. It's probably more so now in the last sort of decade we're actually understanding that there's certain ingredients within these foods that are probably driving some of these responses as opposed to eating 20 onions, for example, for quercetin. So if we say that potentially there's active ingredients that we can target nutritionally, then how do we actually fit them into the adaptive response? So I think the next thing we then need to do is say, well, what do we know is actually happening with exercise that we might be able to target? So you've seen lots of these kind of diagrams today already, and Brenda did a lovely job of eloquently talking you through these things. But the point being, and the reason why exercise is so great, is it elicits so many different changes in the cell environment that drives this response going forward. So we know there's lots of things going on at the membrane that will drive some of these processes. There's aspects of nutritional stress or energy sensing that will occur, and ultimately these things will change transcriptional programs that will drive the metabolic changes. So if we know that these molecular signals are going up with exercise, can we now start targeting some of these things with compounds that might do the same kind of thing? So moving on to this first kind of theme or strategy and the idea of these epicatechins, the interesting thing about these, when you look at the cellular levels, they seem to change aspects of this part of the pathway. So there's some evidence around changes in nitric oxide signaling, AMPK activation, that ultimately might drive this. So this is the first kind of area that I'm gonna focus on, this idea of epicatechins. And as I said, it's a nice topic for everyone, because we know that particularly this epicatechin is enriched in cocoa beans and highly enriched in dark chocolate. So that's pleasing if you like dark chocolate. But the point being is that this is the active ingredient in these things, rather than eating kilos and kilos of dark chocolate. But a really elegant study came out from Mo Malik's group, actually, in Journal of Physiology a few years ago now, actually, where they looked at the basically supplementing mice with a training period with this epicatechin compound. So I think the thing I like particularly here was that they were actually interested in the additive effects with exercise rather than trying to replace exercise. So we have four different groups. So we have just a water control, water exercise, epicatechin on its own without exercise, but then they thankfully did a combined group, so they've got the epicatechin plus exercise. This is, again, as David and Brennan have already spoken a lot about, this is now the protein content change of the electron transport chain subunits 1, 2, 3, and 5, normalize the gap DH, and you can see a nice staircase effect where you have an exercise response. The epicatechins alone actually elicited quite a big change in the protein content, but the biggest effect on its own was the combined supplementation plus exercise. It also seemed to have quite pronounced effects on the mitochondrial reticulum or the mitochondrial structure, which is, I think, quite intriguing as a compound moving forward. So these are markers of mitochondrial membrane content. I think the next slide shows it really quite nicely, where just using epicatechin supplementation alone compared to water pronounced pretty striking changes really in the ultrastructure of the muscle in terms of striation and organization. This is pretty drastic changes from just a drinking water trial alone. And then when they actually went with the EM to actually quantify some of these changes, this is the control, this is the epicathechin, and you can see just changes in the actual structure of the organization that's quantified in a greater ratio of the outer to inner membrane and the inner to outer membrane. So again, as David alluded to, you should see these changes in the functional capacity of mitochondria as a consequence of this interspatial reorganization. I've lost a slide. They also went on and did a nice study where they did the same thing, but this time detrained rodents. So similar to the study that David showed. What they've now done is they've got a control group, they've trained the group, this is in rats now. They actually had a detraining period for 14 days, and then another group where they detrained and added epicatechins back to that group. And again, it was quite interesting that, as David showed you really nicely, that you get this, in rodents and in humans, you get this nice plasticity of mitochondria, so you get a good training effect. The detraining actually reduces the mitochondria pretty drastically, so this is just 14 days of stopping exercise. But again, the interesting thing here was that when they supplemented epicatechins to the group that was detraining, they were able to retain or maintain the mitochondrial adaptations they saw with training. So there seemed to be I hate to use the word mimetic, but there seemed to be a retained ability of the mitochondria from the training when they had this epicatechin presented to them. So I think those two studies combined actually are quite intriguing. So the same group has tried to translate this, and I'm not going to pretend that this is a particularly large or well-controlled study, but it is a study nonetheless. I think one of the biggest problems, this is a population that's obviously quite metabolically challenged in the first place. So this is heart failure patients, and it's an open label protocol, so they were just giving these groups chocolate and cocoa for a period of time, which again is probably quite an easy study to recruit for in terms of what you're providing. But what was quite striking was the changes they saw, the muscle of these individuals. So I think the difference here is this is not a healthy muscle to start with, so this is aspects of remodeling potentially rather than adaptation. But before and after, these are the individuals, so this is before and after for each of these. This is now the complex 1, the oxphos, complex 5. In all of the patients, they did see an increase in the mitochondrial content when they were supplementing this dark chocolate, which was enriched with epicatechins. Again, when they did the EM to look at the mitochondria, they saw quite stark changes. Again, there's no exercise here. This is just feeding, so I think this is quite interesting, where you see a change in the perimeter organization of the mitochondria. So to sort of summarize the epicatechin work, we've known for a period of time that there are aspects of dark chocolate that do, in moderation, improve aspects of human health. There's a lot of literature around the vasodilatory response to these things and how they can actually change blood flow, which again, I think, probably fits in quite nicely to some of these adaptive responses. Importantly, it seems to be that the epicatechins seem to be the active ingredient in the dark chocolate as opposed to other parts of it. The study that I showed you, the J-Fizz study, I think is really quite intriguing from a translational point of view, that if you supplement epicatechins to mice with training, you augment the training response, and it actually has an effect on its own independent of training. And actually, you know, potentially this is also quite intriguing, that if you had a period of disuse following training, you might actually be able to use a small compound such as this to maintain mitochondrial function, which I think could feed in potentially quite nicely into athlete populations or injury scenarios where you might want to maintain mitochondrial content. But as I've said, to my knowledge, there are no really in-depth detailed studies examining this process in human muscles or training. And I think if there is, I apologize, but I think this is a really nice area that could potentially go forward. So if we move slightly in terms of our focus now, so as I showed you before, we think that aspects of the epicatechins work through this side. A really emerging area in sort of, I guess, mitochondrial biology is the involvement and the signaling properties of NAD, and particularly this aspect of the pathway. And I think one of the most attractive aspects of NAD synthesis or targeting NAD synthesis is just how easy it is to manipulate with nutrition. So there's a huge number of dairy food sources that actually are highly enriched in some of the precursors for NAD synthesis. The one I'm going to really focus on today is nicotinamide riboside, which is NR here. So every time you see NR from now on, this is what we're talking about. But the work from Charles Brenner and other groups has shown really quite nicely now that NR can be transported into the cell, and then through two kinases, NRK1 and 2, can be converted to this intermediate NMN. And then through another enzyme reaction, we'll actually change the abundance of NAD in the cell. There's a lot of interest in this molecule from an aging point of view. There's been a suggestion that NAD in a variety of different tissues will decline with age, and that might relate to some of the changes in energetics of tissue in that context. But I think from the point of today, the important thing here is that we know that with nutrition, we can certainly start influencing some of these precursors that, in theory, and I say in theory, should get to a change in NAD in the target tissue. NR has been studied a little bit more than some of the others because it has been commercialized a number of years ago. So nicotinamide riboside is commercialized by a company called Chromadex. It's based in Orange County in California. There's a commercially available supplement called Niagen that you can purchase that has a high proportion of NR within it. And then if we go to some of the sort of the more basic studies, this is some work from Carlos Canto, who Brendan's already introduced. This is a study he did when he was in Joan Oex's group a few years ago. I think one of the caveats of these types of studies is the majority of the rodent studies that you see are normally in a disease model or a metabolically impaired model at the start. So particularly in this study, this is in CellMet a few years ago, they were looking at the protective effect of NR supplementation in animals in a high-fat background. So what they found quite nicely was that if they supplemented NR to these mice, this was just through the standard chow that they were feeding them, they saw an enrichment of NAD in muscle and brown adipose tissue, change in liver. So some of the more metabolic tissues that you would see in the animals were sensitive to the NR availability. They looked at the EM, this is just from the adipose tissue. These big lumps of stuff is the mitochondria expansion compared to the vehicle control. So there was a pretty dynamic change in the mitochondrial content and ultrastructure of the animals from the NR supplementation. They went and looked at some of the transcription factors and genes that we believe to drive some of the mitochondrial adaptation. It wasn't widespread changes, but there were some changes in aspects of, you already heard about mitofusin 2 in terms of some of the fusion, aspects of the electron transport chain changes, TFAM and citrate synthase. So there was remodeling occurring in response to the NR supplementation. I think probably a little bit more relevant in terms of function, there was an increase in complex 5 protein content in parallel to some of the gene changes, and an increase in mitochondrial DNA. So there was certainly a remodeling in the mice when they were giving NR to the mice. So I think one of the attractive things about NR is that it is commercialized and it has very good safety profiles in humans. There's a couple of nice studies looking at the toxicology and the pharmacokinetics of NR, and it is safe and there's no off-target effects. The other interesting thing about NR is it has very good bioavailability in humans. This is work from Charles Brenner's group. I think it's quite interesting that the figure they show is an N of 1 from a 56-year-old male, which just so happens to be Charles Brenner. But beyond that, I guess he was putting his money where his mouth was to test it on himself. But the thing that was quite interesting, if they took a gram a day, this is the dose response in terms of the dosing. If they took a gram of NR, there was a slight delay, but then a pretty pronounced enrichment of NAD in the circulation. So this is in the blood. So after about 6 hours, I think they got a plateau, and this stayed high for about 24 hours. So again, if you're thinking about this as a supplement or trying to deliver this is quite nice that you can actually take a fairly modest dose. So I think they went up to about 1,500, but 1,000 milligrams seemed to be about as optimal as needed. So a single dose of 1,000 milligrams can elevate NAD in the circulation quite pronounced in humans. So we've been sort of looking at NR for a couple of years now, actually, and I've done a few human studies that are yet to publish. I've been a bit slack since I went to sunny Sydney. This is one of the first studies we did. This is from Lizzie Gray, who was a master's student in my group. We it's one of those sort of things where you have a compound that you know is safe to use, but where do you actually begin? So we just decided to do an acute dose and just see if there's any sort of acute responses to a single dose approach. We didn't, in all honesty, expect there to be based on some of the literature, but as I said, you have to start somewhere. So she recruited 12 healthy males. The protocol itself was about an hour of a steady state exercise at 6% work max, and then we gave them a little break, and then they did a 5K time trial. So to lead into this repeatability, they acclimated to the time trial three different occasions beforehand. And then there was two experimental trials where it was a double-blind randomized design. So they either had a 1,000 milligrams, a gram of NR, again, based on this, based on the work from Brenner, or a placebo. So they took the NR the night before, so came into lab 12 hours after that ingestion. So we thought we should get them in around about this sweet spot where you've got this elevation in circulating NAD, and then they performed these tests. And as typically happens in my life in science, we saw no effect, but that tends to be the way these things go. So if we look at just free fatty acids, lactate, glycerol, or plasma glucose, we saw the responses we expected to see in regard to exercise, but there was no changes when we compared the NR to the placebo. Again, if you actually use some of the standard equations based on the calorimetry to look at calculate rates of fat oxidation or carbohydrate oxidation, there was an effect of exercise as we anticipated, but there wasn't a difference between groups. And you can't really get much closer data in terms of no change for the placebo and NR in that 5K time trial. So certainly in our hands, a single dose doesn't seem to have an effect if you just look at substrate utilization during steady state exercise. So we've also done another study that's yet to be published. This is work in collaboration with Gareth Lavery and Yasir, who's he's now a PhD student at the University of Birmingham. They're based in the IMSR at Birmingham. The idea here was this is a nice pilot study funded by the Medical Research Council in the UK. And the study design was looking at old individuals where we're supplementing for 21 days of NR. So this is the basic run through. So they had a biopsy, 21 days, a number of different, a battery of tests. We had a washout. And then they did the opposite trial, so it's a randomized double-blind study. So we have an N of 10 in terms of the participants, all males, around about mean age was around about 65 years old. And again, we saw no real effect of NR supplementation in this cohort. So this is now our mitochondrial respiration. Not that it really matters because they're all the same, but the placebo is in purple, NR is in blue. So we saw no effect of the NR supplementation on mitochondrial function. Sugeo synthase activity was maintained between the groups. So this is the baseline, NR and placebo. And the battery test that we did in terms of just general adaptation, we didn't see any differences. So again, it's one of those things that you go into this with high hopes based on some rodent studies and don't necessarily see the responses that you predicted. But again, if you think of it in a bigger context, it's maybe not that surprising. But we wanted to sort of actually check that things were happening as they wanted to. So Charles Brenner kindly helped us to measure the muscle NAD metabolome. So this is a targeted LC-MS/MS method that gives you around about 40 metabolites within the metabolome. And just for there's a lot of abbreviations in this kind of field. So just to talk you through it, we should expect to see NR converted to NMN and then eventually NAD. And then one of the nice things that Charles showed in his work is that quite often you don't necessarily see a change in NAD in tissues, but you do see byproducts of the breakdown of NAD. So there's a couple of methylated byproducts that you can pick up quite nicely that would be indicative of greater NAD flux or turnover. And at the same time, you might also see changes in NADP and NAAD. So this is effectively a nice readout of turnover. And if we work our way through, we didn't see huge changes in NR, which is what we expected, except for these two characters here. I'm not sure what happened here. But there was no real change of NAD, NAM. Some changes in NAAD, suggesting that maybe NAD turnover was changing. But beyond that, not really much showed up, which certainly in our interpretation suggests that potentially the supplementation was unable to affect NAD in skeletal muscle. I won't show you the data. If you compare this to the blood, there was a huge change of the supplementation. So at present, we just think that this strategy is unable to target skeletal muscle as opposed to some of the other organs. So there's a number of things that might affect this. We'll hold our hands up that certainly it's a fairly small sample size. Supplementation period is not very long. But there's scope to look at this in more detail. So to summarize this aspect in terms of NAD donors, boosting NAD content in skeletal muscle does appear to be able to change things quite dramatically in the context of mitochondrial adaptation in cell and rodent models. NR is an attractive precursor in terms of human studies because of the biosafety and the tolerance to this. But despite NR being commercialized, there's no published studies to date looking at these things in human skeletal muscle. So again, a good window of opportunity there. So just for the last couple of minutes, I'm just going to go to the last strategy that, again, I think is quite intriguing because it's different to the others in the sense that rather than targeting particularly some of the signaling cascades, what fish oil seems to be able to do is actually change some of the membrane structure of either the cell membrane or, if I had it on here, the mitochondrial membrane. And again, there's a lot of health benefits around fish oil. There's a large business around these things. You can go to most stores and buy these things. But in terms of oxidative capacity, there's not huge amounts of literature, but I think there's some intriguing studies. So this is a paper published a few years ago now from Peoples and McLennan. They were supplementing rats for 8 weeks and then looked at the actual composition of the gastroc muscles. So these are the different heads of the gastroc, whether it's the red or the white, and looked at the incorporation of fatty acids into these into the fibers of supplementation. And the nice thing is you see a nice enrichment of the N3 proofers in the with the supplementation compared to others. So again, it's quite a specific strategy for increasing the content. The consequence of this is when you have a higher abundance of N3s within the tissues, you actually have a improved recovery. So this is an eccentric exercise, effectively a damage protocol, and looking at recovery rates. So the closer the groups come to 100, the more closely they get back to their full rested state. So when there was high N3s in tissue, there was a greater recovery, where it's initial, maximum, and final. The muscle had a greater fatigue protection or recovery. And there also seems to be an increased oxygen efficiency during that period. So this is like the opposite. So effectively, the recovery was coming back, but the amount of oxygen required to drive that was less. So there was an improved efficiency of the skeletal muscle in terms of its recovery. So pretty indirect in relation to mitochondria, but knowing muscle as we do, you'd anticipate that for these kind of changes to occur, there's probably some remodeling at the level of the oxidative capacity. What do we know about human studies? There was some nice data came out of, this is from Chris McGlory's PhD when he was with Kev Tipton in Stirling. This really was to set up some of the other studies he performed in relation to muscle hypertrophy, but what they showed quite nicely was that if you supplement individuals with 5 grams a day of fish oil over 4 weeks, over time you get a nice enrichment of the N3s at about 4 weeks in the muscle. The blood relationship is obviously a lot quicker, but you can actually enrich skeletal muscle N3 content at that time, and this is the ratio of the two. So as a strategy, it is feasible in humans. This is a really elegant paper that came from Graham Holloway's lab a few years ago. Again, these studies are not easy to do in humans, so spectacular work. If you heard his talk at this meeting, they've done some really nice work looking at sensitivity of mitochondria to different treatments. But again, this was quite exciting that when they supplemented humans, they were able to see enrichment of N3s in the mitochondrial membrane. So this was really quite intriguing, and it's not just the plasma membrane, but the mitochondrial membrane will be targeted, and it seems to be specifically to EPA and DHA. And the consequence of this is a greater sensitivity of the mitochondria to ADP stimulation. So the net effect of this is you have a more efficient mitochondria. So again, I think this moving forward is could be quite relevant, that if you've got a more efficient mitochondria, a more efficient or susceptible membrane, potentially this might allow a greater adaptation with exercise. So it appears that fish oils work in a nice way. Rather than changing potentially the signaling, they can actually affect the the structure of mitochondria that as a consequence might change some of the signaling. So this is adapted from another study, but we know that DHA and EPA will incorporate into membranes. This could be your cell membrane or your mitochondrial membrane, and this might change the viscosity, the tolerance, or the elasticity of the mitochondrial membrane. So sorry I whizzed through that a little bit. I blame people for stealing my time. But basically, again, I think there's not huge amounts of literature around this, but I was working with fairly limited studies. The ones that are, I think, are very detailed and very well designed, which I think is why we can take this quite nicely. But fish oil supplementation increases enrichment of particularly the N3s in muscle and in blood. It takes a little bit longer to get into the muscle, but it does get there. The supplementation enriches this composition, and I think excitingly also in the mitochondrial membrane just as much as the whole cell membrane. Fish oil supplementation increases muscle fatigue and resistance, so again as a readout of oxidative capacity, this is quite nice. It will change mitochondrial respiration, but again I'm not aware of studies that have looked at fish oil supplementation in combination with endurance training to see if it can augment those effects. So just to finish, we know that endurance training can change mitochondrial adaptation. Based on the studies I showed you from the literature, there doesn't seem to be a requirement for a standardized nutrition to support that, although I would like to say that I think if we redid those studies with an optimal nutrition program or a change in a nutritional program, potentially we might augment that adaptive response. However, evidence suggests that we do know that we can change nutrition and change some of these responses. I think nutraceuticals might be a nice way of doing this because it's a fairly small compound you can deliver in quite a precise way. But again, at this point in time, and I think this is a really nice opportunity for the field to move forward, as there's very limited studies examining the impact of these strategies in combination with endurance training. So on that note, I will just finish. I'd like to acknowledge funders and thank you all for sticking around. Thank you.